Get your number.
Ladies and gentlemen, up until now, you've seen the creature perform the simple mechanics of motor activity. But for what you're about to see next, we must enter quietly into the realm of genius. Ladies and gentlemen, mesdames et messieurs, damen und herren, from what was once an inarticulate mass of lifeless tissues, may I now present a cultured, sophisticated, man about town. Hit it!
The Sketch-O-Matic Show.
Woo! Shee!
Back again.
Sketch-O-Matic.
A week off the podcast.
Sketchy.
Feeling refreshed and recharged.
Yeah!
And always thrilled to be here with you. I appreciate your company and your business right here with me.
Sketch-O-Matic.
This episode, we are going to feature a very dear friend of mine from way, way, way back. This man has DJed all over the world. He's been an innovator in the DJ realm for decades.
Wow.
It is because of this man, this innovator, that influenced so many DJs from all over the world to get into the DJing game, including myself. In today's episode, we dive deep into his history, his upbringing, and the recent loss of his father. I'd like to say thank you to my special guest for allowing himself to be so open and so vulnerable in this podcast. This podcast would be a safe space for that, for people to explain their life story without feeling judged or put into a certain narrative or type of light. Or a woe is me type of feeling. It's not any of that. It's life. And we talk about it. And we talk about the DJing as well. And the music. And the radio. And all that. I just wanted to say thank you to my special guest up front. Because it is such an honor and a pleasure to have this man with me on this episode. Oh, before I even forget. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention. That this podcast was recorded at iHeart Studios. Meaning. There's multiple studios in the building. From time to time, I'll record the podcast in one studio or maybe record it in another studio. And this time around, in this episode, episode 12, there's good news and there's bad news. I'll start with the bad news. The bad news is this podcast was previously recorded in a prod room that unfortunately had a technical glitch in one of the mics. Okay. Now, in all of my effort and all of my knowledge to try to remedy this glitch in the microphone, which was causing the microphone to not record clearly, I couldn't fix it. And I was pressed for time. I was in a time restraint. I had to get the interview recorded, get it going so that I can tend to my other obligations for the rest of the day, meaning my regular job. I decided to press on with the interview and just record it as is. The good news is it's my mic. My mic sounds like shit. Fortunately, my special guest mic sounds crispy clean like a washing machine. It's like night and day. Okay, so just as a disclaimer up front, please forgive the crappy sounding microphone which I was on, but today's special guest was on the proper microphone, and I will make sure to fix that moving forward. Okay, without further ado, episode
12.
Let's dive in.
Oh my god. Special guest from the world famous Beat Junkies and Beat Junkies Institute of Sound, Mr. Choc.
That's right, you heard her. From the world famous Beat Junkies.
Ooh.
Man, it is so good to see you, Mr. Choc.
Hey, what up, Sketch-O-Matic? How you doing, sir?
He is on the Sketch-O-Matic Show podcast.
Man.
And this is
long time coming.
Probably one of the longest overdue interview interaction conversations I've been meaning to have.
Oh man.
Because
thanks,
man, we go so far back.
Yes,
you're
we
a
do.
Dear friend of mine. I know I haven't seen you for quite some time in person.
Yeah.
We've run into each other
here
and there over, you know, some industry stuff.
Actually, the last time I saw
was
you
Big Boy's party.
Was Big Boy's party when he got the star on the Walk
exactly.
of Fame.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And congratulations again to Big Boy for that.
Yeah, congrats, Big. What up, Big?
Yes, sir. Big. Yeah. He was on the podcast recently, too.
Yeah, I saw the post about that, man. Yeah.
We dove deep into a two-hour convo.
Ooh.
Yeah, it was really... I could have talked to him for like another 13 days. You know what I mean?
Course.
Like, the radio history and all that. But today we are featuring you, Mr. Choc.
Hey.
It is so wonderful to have you here. And I got to admit, I was nervous, like I said to you pre-podcasting. I was a little nervous because I hadn't seen you in so long. And because I know you, and this is a good nerve. It's just a good excitement. Because I was like, man, when he comes to the show, like I want him, you know, when he comes to, because we're recording from the iHeart Studios.
Yes.
And we were talking, oh, we could have recorded this, you know, at your house. We could have done it over Zoom and we could just smoke together and whatnot. I felt like you deserve the treatment of coming to the station.
Man, that means,
you
know, a lot of sketch.
Yeah,
man.
Because you're a pioneer in the DJing hip hop music world, man. You know, you're one of those guys.
I'm definitely an old guy now. Well, pioneer means an old guy to me.
Pioneer in the sense of you were like one of the innovators that made it what it is today, especially on the West Coast, for sure.
Man, thank you for that.
And it's just a fact, because for me, growing up DJing, I watched Big Boy DJ. I watched DJ Ray DJ. Remember DJ Ray? Shout out to DJ Ray.
What up, Ray?
But like, there was when I got to see you and, like, you know, E-Man back in the day, before I even went
what
to
up,
go
E-Man?
Work with, when I saw you guys doing your thing, it took it to another level for me. It was like Tron. You know what I mean? It was like, it was mystical, and there was no social media.
Right,
there was no way of, I didn't know what you look like. I know originally you went by Mr. Chocolate, right?
Yeah. Before
Mr. Choc.
It was always DJ Chocolate, DJ Choc, you know? And then when I got to Power in 95, I decided to take the DJ off because I felt like everyone was becoming a, you know,
right.
I've seen the trend of DJing come and go so many different times. And so at that time, when I got to Power, I saw the trend of DJing coming back again. Everybody was putting DJ in front of their name. Mm-hmm. So I was like, at that point when I got to Power, it was 10 years for me, for DJing.
Oh, you already put in a decade.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I put in a decade. So I was like, you know, I think I'm going to switch my name now that I'm on this, like, now that I'm at my dream job, which is Power 106.
And I want to ask you, but I want to dive into that. If we could take a side dive
before
we get in. Well, I want you to finish the name change, but I really was thinking, like, I never asked you this. How did you not only get into DJing, what was that inspiration, but what got you to Power?
We can talk about all that.
There's just so many questions, and of course about DJing, the craft itself. I want to get into the Beat Junkies.
Yeah.
Hold on, I want to get this right. Say it for me.
Beat Junkie Institute of Sound.
So it's so fancy and so it's so professional. It sounds like almost like a Dolby Atmos.
Yeah. It's definitely like a scratch dojo, a DJ dojo for sure. And that's what we strive to be.
I want to talk about that as well, and the start of that, and where it is today.
Yeah.
And how it survived through COVID.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, there's so many just avenues of conversation to have with you, Mr. Choc.
Yeah, let's
but again, I have to thank you for taking the time to come down here.
My pleasure, Sketch, man.
I know we live close by, but
we've been homies for the longest, man. And so, like, you call, man, I'm coming all the time, man.
Thank you, sir.
But to go back to my name change, after 10 years of DJing, and when I finally got the opportunity, myself and C-Minus, my brother, Almighty Roughnecks, we got the opportunity to come and try out for Power. And
How did you do that? Who
We were actually, we had been doing radio for, I want to say like 2-3 years at that point.
Where?
In Bakersfield.
That's where, okay.
We grew up with the Baker Boys.
That's
so myself and C-Minus and Eric and Nick and, you know,
family.
The whole Vidal family, you know, we all grew up together. And
shout out to the Bakers.
Yeah, shout out to the Baker Boys for sure.
Those guys are
my man. I actually just went to a birthday party for Eric V.
Yeah.
I saw last Friday. Yeah.
I saw that post.
Yeah.
You guys look real dapper.
Oh, thanks, man.
Real distinguished gentleman.
Yeah. You know, we got the silver fox thing going
it's
on now.
Dope, though. I like the charcoal gray. Here's the thing about Mr. Choc. If I got a side digress real quick about
of course.
Physical, because we're not on video and I do this on purpose for myself because, well, let's face it, I'm a funny looking guy. I don't belong on video. Voice for television, face for radio, as they always say. But
come
with you,
now.
Mr. Choc, when I saw you, You don't age, man.
I do.
You have gray.
Yeah.
But your face still looks the same.
Yeah.
As it did back then. It's just you're just older in the terms of age years.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
your
for
face,
sure.
There's no wrinkles.
Yeah. Well,
you got great skin.
Oh, thanks,
man. What's
going
on here?
Thank you,
brother. You're like Benjamin Button, but in like you're just holding.
Well,
steady.
They always say the whole thing, black don't crack. So I'm gonna run with that. You know what I'm saying? But yeah, man, I just wash my face and, and keep moisturizers on my face. You know, we're black people, we gotta put lotion on.
True.
So
I
like
mean, you look
like,
at Big, he still he looks better now.
Yeah,
and,
yeah,
you know, obviously he's aged well. You grow into yourself, but you look great, Mr. Choc.
Thank you so much, man.
Really do, and I'm not just blowing smoke, even though I'd like to blow smoke with you.
Yes for
thank
sure
you. But yeah, okay, so the Bakers, the Vidal family, right?
yes
they, you're growing up in Bakersfield and they get into radio, you follow yeah. suit
or, we were always fans of LA radio from 1580 K-Day. So the thing is how I even connected with the Baker Boys, I was always a B-boy, a breakdancer. So my whole introduction into the DJ world comes from breakdancing.
Ah.
And I saw, when I first, see the thing is I was buying records at the age of 13. Just for dancing purposes.
And
though.
Who were some of your artists back then in the 80s and stuff that were breakdancing that like
Egyptian Lover. Like all like the techno hop records, yeah. So we're talking like Planet Rock
and like It's Time.
Yeah, It's Time, Hashim.
Yeah,
It's Time.
Cybertron Clear. Twilight 22, Electric Kingdom. So I was buying like all those records because I was breaking back then.
Mm-hmm.
I'd always like heard scratching. And my introduction to DJing is when I was actually at like a B-boy battle in Bakersfield at Roller Town.
How hip hop is that?
Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
Roller Town.
Yeah, you know, like roller rink. And
I know. We had World on Wheels out here.
Yeah, yeah. I know. I used to come out for that,
yes,
also, too.
Dude,
you know?
We would do like parties or appearances there before Power.
Yeah. So me being at those breakdancing battles, I would see a guy by the name of DJ Sparkle who just passed away. Rest in peace.
Man, rest in peace, Sparkle.
And, Sparkle would be playing like two copies of the same record, and I was like, oh, that's how they do it, because I was always curious about like how they make it sound.
Me too.
There were certain things that, like, you know,
how are they going back and forth,
back
like
and
that,
forth
and rewinding and starting it over,
and why is certain things repeating, you know? So I didn't understand that, but then I saw it in person,
and that just changed your life.
Changed everything.
It was an instant
and change.
How old are you at this point?
13. No, 13, yeah. 14.
You're like
brand
new
teenager. 13, 14 years old, yeah,
and you're seeing DJing in person for at a B-boy battle, and you breakdance to
I was breaking, yeah.
And did you win the battle?
The last battle that we had in Bakersfield, my group, the Four Masters, we won the very last battle in Bakersfield that they had. And so, yeah, we like to say like, yeah, we're the champs, man. You know what I'm saying?
But there's something else that just popped into mind about like Jurassic 5. I mean, all the different hip hop, like, roads you've traveled is phenomenal. I mean, you've lived and you're still living it, but so far up to this very point right now in our lives together, you've done so much. You've traveled so much. You've DJed all over the world, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I don't even know where to begin, but let's keep going.
Well, you know,
I'm just so excited.
I will say this, that when I was a young teen and before I saw Sparkle, it was something that I, like, you know, I would always listen to mix shows. So we had, like, a local mix show in Bakersfield, a guy by the name of Coffee Dog. Rest in peace.
And
the Baker Boys.
Another great fallen soldier, right?
Yeah, yeah. You know, so I would listen to those shows and just, like, kind of get hip to the music or whatever. Like, I was, like when hip-hop started, I was right there. And I was all on top of it, you know what I'm saying? I was writing down lyrics. I learned all the lyrics to Rock the Bells. I used to rap along with LL Cool J when the song would play.
Did you ever do some rapping as well?
I tried a little bit, you know what I'm saying? I like to call myself a shower rapper.
Oh, yeah.
But in high school, I rapped a little bit, like, for, like, maybe 2 years. And then after I started getting to DJing, I started DJing at the age of 15. So I started buying records at the age of 13 because of breakdancing.
And just collecting
the records, and just like, so I'm going to have something at home to practice.
Now, were you buying doubles before the turntables came about?
No, I was only buying singles at the time. So I was mainly buying 12-inch singles.
Right. I mean, plus, you know, buying records back then was still pricey.
Yeah, and I still didn't understand, like, what the whole thing about doubles yet until I actually saw it in front of me. And then when I saw it in front of me, I was like, oh.
I see. Okay.
Two copies of the same record.
Sounds expensive.
Yeah, very expensive. I still didn't know what I was doing, but I understood that in order for me to get better at these techniques that I'm seeing in front of me, I have to buy.
And it was Technique 1200s even back then.
Yes.
And they're still around.
And they're the best turntables ever.
They are.
They are actual tanks.
I mean, who created those things, man? Who came up with it? And just the way they look is so mysterious. Like the dots on the side with the red stroke.
Well, the dots on the side, you know what those are.
They tell the speed.
Yeah, you can tell the speed.
But still, to think of that idea. And then to have that red light, you know, and then the power switch, and then the other little light. It's all the little cool lights that work together.
Yeah.
And then we're talking.
Oh, you're talking about the light that you actually hit and it comes up.
And then
you can see the grooves on the record.
You can see the needle on the groove, which you really don't need anymore thanks to phase and all that.
But we'll talk about that too. Yes, we'll talk about phase and everything too.
In essence of the turntable itself, it fascinates me that there's a lot of turntables that exist, but that became the staple of DJing from the very beginning.
There's a lot of companies that have come close to replicating what the Technique 1200 is, but I will say the Technique 1200 still stands alone. And you know, as far as like for me, you know what I'm saying? Like I if I go somewhere and on my rider, I definitely have Technique 1200s over everything else. Now, if they have something like a Pioneer turntable or any type of, you know, saying I can't even think of all the other
Vestex
companies.
Right? And Vestex. Rain has turntables now.
No, Rain doesn't. Well, they have controllers. Right. Rain doesn't have turntables. Actually, Rain has the big controller.
Yeah,
the big controller turntable.
It looks like it has the Technique turntable plates.
Yeah. It's similar to a turntable. Those are actually pretty good. Rain controllers.
Those are the closest of controllers I ever, and I grant you, I don't DJ nearly as much as you do. Uh-huh. I do DJ a little bit here and there, and I DJed in Madison, Wisconsin.
Oh, really?
For a CrossFit game.
Oh, look
thing.
At you.
And it was like during the festivities and the different games and stuff, but they had a controller there.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, man, I don't know how to use this thing.
Yeah.
And you know the guy in charge, DJ Lucky Lou, was like, "Man, just figure
Lucky
it out."
Lou.
Yeah,
Lucky Lou from here,
yeah,
LA.
Yeah.
Oh, what up, Lou? What up,
like,
man?
He brought me out there for the games, and it was a team of DJs that he put together, and I just was a little I was nervous. He's like, "Bro, you're not DJing at Tao."
The Rain 12s. Yeah. I kept thinking, what are they called? The Rain 12s. Yeah. So
but it was cool, man.
Yeah, no. but I've rocked on those. I've pretty much rocked on any type of turntable. But again, for me, I need the Technique 1200s. Right. You know what I'm saying?
Like, do you still have the original Technique 1200s you had when you were 15 now?
No, I don't.
You got rid of them.
No, well, I won't even go into the story what happened to those, but no, I have some new ones since I wish I still had those because then you know, it's always good to kind of like remember where you come from and like kind of like I have every mixer that I've ever had.
Wow.
But I still have all of those and I keep those just to remember like the struggle to like because now like we have like the best equipment now that the DJ world has had,
top of the line,
Serato, you know, Pioneer's definitely making the top of the line mixers with the S9, S11, S7.
They're like Nikes of DJ world.
Pioneer's done it
for sure.
And definitely salute to Pioneer. They're definitely one of our sponsors at the school also too, along with Serato.
Yeah, man.
And you
that's
know,
something else that's amazing that you guys put together that school.
Yeah, you know,
Institute. I'm sorry, it's not a school. It's an institute.
The Institute of Sound. What's crazy is that I started teaching DJing. Well, okay, let's take it back.
Let's rewind a little bit. And by the way, you're totally feel free to digress into inception of digression. There's no. I mean, obviously, there's somewhat of a structure, and there's so many questions to get to, but if you think of something, you dive into it.
Yeah.
We fast forward back and all that.
I've been DJing for 37 years now at this point.
Wow.
And with no break, no...
You never took a vacation? Like a year off?
No.
Wow.
No. The longest I've ever been from it was probably when this year when my dad passed, and that was for a month.
Now, I want to get into that, too, because Big Boy would say, we're part of a fucked up club.
Yeah.
Which, you know, losing your parents is a very tough... Is your mom still with us?
No.
My mom
passed actually 10 years ago.
Oh, shit.
So she... yesterday was my daughter's birthday.
Right. Happy birthday, Amanda.
And my mom passed on my daughter's birthday 10 years ago. So yesterday was the 10-year anniversary. Well, I won't say anniversary, but her passing.
Yes. No, my mom, 5 years. Mm-hmm. I fully can relate.
Yeah.
But with your pops, you were close to your father. My dad took off when I was 16. So, uh-huh. You know, my dad, I always seeked male role models throughout my life from a very early age once my dad started kind of drifting out of the picture. Yeah. But he still taught me about recording and audio. So he left somewhat of an impression on me, and he wasn't a bad guy.
Right.
But your father and you seem very, very close.
We were very close. Right. I was close with my mom also too, Calvin.
Calvin,
my,
that's right.
My dad, Calvin
Thurston. Right.
Yeah. And I was always in awe of my dad. My dad wasn't into like music or anything. He was more like he's a farmer, or a very hard worker. You know, he taught me a lot of different things, from driving, how to ride a horse.
Wow.
You know, because I grew up on a farm.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what my mom.
In Bakersfield, right?
In Bakersfield, yeah.
Your parents were from Bakersfield originally?
My mom and dad are originally from Texas.
Interesting.
Yeah. And they moved at an early age because of just like how people were being treated back
then.
Black people especially.
Of course.
You know, so they left.
It's like a different planet back then.
Yeah, yeah. So they left at an early age to come to California for more opportunity. And thank God they did, you know what I'm saying? Because I don't know how I would be if I would have grown up in those places where, like, there's still a lot of racial tension right now.
Right,
you know what
man.
I'm saying? And you know, I grew up with my mom and dad telling me stories of things that they went through. And
the struggles, man.
Yeah, the
real,
struggles.
Bro.
And, you know, being in Bakersfield, that's the only place I really experienced a lot of racism, where people actually use the N-word when describing us. Because, you know, for me, you know, I'm black, but I'm like, you know, like, I'm the type of black where, like, you could, like, oh, he's dark-skinned black. You know what I'm saying? It's like, yeah, you know what I'm saying?
You're not like like a Beyonce tone or something.
Right,
like
right. I'm not light-skinned. You know what I'm saying? So you could definitely see that, he's black. You know what I'm saying? Or probably some people think I'm Dominican or Puerto Rican they hear my real name, because my real name is Carlos.
Yeah. Which is, you know, Carlos is such a, it's a good name, and you look like, it fits you. But so does Mr. Choc. But you look like, I mean, look at me. People think I'm Armenian. They think I could be Egyptian, Persian. They don't know what.
Even I never thought about that.
Still don't know what sketch is, for real. You know what I mean? I'm Mexican. And I've said that on the podcast. You know, I'm from Mexico City. Uh-huh. I don't speak Spanish, right? Uh-huh. Do you speak Spanish? You do, right?
Very little. Poquito
más.
Yes.
I like eating there. It's great.
Yes, it's very good.
Remember?
I love poquito más.
Poquito más?
Yes, right across the street from Power.
You want to cover the one?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so with your father,
I learned a lot from him, just as far as like being a
I wanted to offer my condolences for that.
Thank you.
Earlier, but I wanted to officially say it publicly, podcast publicly, that I am sorry about that, man.
Thank you so much, man.
You know, that affects me too.
Yeah.
Because it's such a void.
And it's something that I'm still trying
processing.
To, the processing, mm-hmm. still grieving over. I'm still trying to figure out, like, that void will never ever be filled. No. But you know, I find myself lost sometimes, you
absolutely.
Know, like, because I used to call him just to, like, not even like to get any advice or anything, but just to talk to him,
right?
You know what I'm saying? And
how
and,
old was your father?
My dad was 93.
Wow.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a long.
Yeah, he lived his life.
He lived through COVID.
Yeah, he lived through COVID.
And then we've suffered other losses as well. I want to point out and spotlight Byze One.
Byze One was my oldest friend.
Yes.
I've known Byze since I was 13 years old.
And he was also from Bakersfield.
Yes, also from Bakersfield.
I didn't know that.
We met. He was in an opposing B-boy crew called the Uptown Rockers. I was in a group called the Floor Masters. So that's how we originally met at a young age, like 12, 13 years old, because from b-boying, but we didn't know each other back then. We just knew of each other.
Right, because of
we didn't officially meet until I was 15. And
did you guys face off in a battle?
I mean, our crews battled each other, but we never faced off against each other as far as like individual
solo
dancing. Yeah, solo dancing. No, we never battled each other like that. But my official introduction to Byze came at the age of 15. A mutual friend of ours. And him came and picked me up at high school and in 85. And and it's so funny, just to tell you this story real quick. So, you know, again, like, I'm at this point at 15, 85, I'm getting into DJing. And so I know who like the heavyweight DJs are. I know about the Mixmasters and KDAY 1580. I know who everybody is. I've been recording mixes, because where I lived on the outskirts of Bakersfield. So where I lived at, I could still get K-Day at late at night, not during the day, but late at night, I could get it from where I was living at.
50,000 watt.
AM
Stereo, KDAY, Santa Monica, Los Angeles.
That's crazy. Why do you think that was, that the signal came in better at
night? It was AM. I don't know. I can't even explain it why, but what a blessing it was. Because it definitely steered me in the direction of becoming a DJ.
Oh, absolutely. So, it had its influence on you.
Yeah, for sure. So going back to Byze, when Byze and our mutual friend came and picked me up at high school, he was introduced to me as Junior, which is the name that we always called him,
right?
Javier.
Javier's his real name.
Right, Javier Ramirez. Right. But everyone called him Junior.
You know something? I never knew that until after he passed away.
Yeah.
I always thought his name was. I mean, I thought his last name was Byze or something, or it was like
that's his middle name. Byze was his graffiti name.
Yeah.
It was his tag name. Yeah.
Byze is such a unique name in general. Byze, right?
Yeah, and that's why he rode with it because you know. But for those who don't know, Byze was amazing at everything. Byze was amazing at everything. But Byze was also
in the hip-hop community.
But Byze was a hell of a graffiti artist at one time, and still was a dope artist before he passed also too. But going back, so when they came and picked me up at high school, they were playing a mixtape.
On a cassette.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And it was a mix and somebody was getting busy on the cut. And I was like, man, who is this?
Who was it?
And then my mutual friend says, my man, Mike Rugnow, he said, it's this guy right here.
Byze One.
But it was Junior Gonzalez.
Oh, it's JG.
JG. But the reason why he said Junior Gonzalez, because he was trying to say that he was the cousin or the little brother of Tony Gonzalez from here, Tony G. Saying the legendary Tony G. What up, Tony?
Legendary LA pioneer.
Yeah, yeah. So he said he was the little brother or cousin
of
him.
Funny. Was he though?
No, he wasn't.
But
just talking smack. Or whatever.
Right.
So, you know, I'm sitting up here in awe of the mix. Like, oh my God, I'm sitting next to one of the KD Mixmaster's brothers, and I'm tripping out and stuff. And then it was a big joke after like maybe 10 minutes of making them believe me. I was super gullible at the time, and you know, and he eventually introduced himself. And then I remembered him. I said, oh, you used to be in the Uptown Rockers, and yeah, you used to be in the Floormasters. And from there, man,
Byze come from though the name.
Byze was, again, that was his graffiti name.
But so, how did he create that name?
I don't remember exactly how he, but you know, like every graffiti name always had a very unique name and a very unique way that they would tag their name.
Yeah.
So I think just from like the history of seeing graffiti artists and stuff, he wanted to come up with something that was still representing for the B-Boys, but also for graffiti also too. So I think like Byze, just to me, it's always been like a super B-boy hip hop
so cool
name. Like you could be a graffiti artist, you could be a DJ, you could be a B-boy, all of that with just the name Byze. And that's what he was. He was all of that. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? But
rest in peace, Byze. I miss that dude.
But but he was my oldest friend.
Yeah.
And we came up in this business together along with C-Minus. Mm-hmm. And man, it was just pretty devastating. It was like my dad passed.
Yeah, he was like your brother. Byze is like
Byze is definitely
your
my brother.
Passing.
My dad passed in on Tuesday of 2/22/22.
I mean, that is such a significant number.
Yeah,
it really is.
He passed on that was a Tuesday, if I remember correctly.
I mean, if there's any more twos in there,
yeah, that's what everyone. Well, his birthday is 12/12/28.
Wow,
that's my dad's birthday.
That's crazy. 12/12/28. When's your birthday?
3/4/7.
That's right. You're a Pisces, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Man. Yeah, yeah. My one of my best friends, Splice, he's March 3rd. And
I know Splice.
Yeah, you know
Splice. Yeah, what up, Splice? Yeah. How you doing, man?
Yeah, there's definitely a connection in the similarities of personalities.
For sure.
And
for
friendliness.
Sure. For sure.
You know, anyways, but yes.
My dad passed on a Tuesday, and then when my dad got sick and went down, I actually left Bakersfield to go and help my sister take care of our dad.
Can I ask how? What happened?
It was prostate cancer.
Oh, yeah. Shit, man. But at 93.
Yeah.
And he never suffered from any of those ailments prior to that.
I mean,
or did he?
He was diagnosed with it, I want to say it was 2019, 2020. Actually, it was 2020, the beginning, right before the pandemic hit.
Mm.
He was, we knew he had prostate cancer, and he didn't have any complications from it.
Right.
He went to the hospital just to get the regular checkup and stuff. He went in a couple of times for pneumonia, but you know, he was a strong man, one of the strongest men I've ever known. And you know, when all that started happening, it was just pretty devastating. So yeah, I went home to go help take care of him, knowing what the inevitable was coming.
It was coming.
It was coming.
And there's nothing you can do about it.
There's nothing you can do.
Was he at a treatment or they were just like, nah, it's not.
No, we were in and out of the hospital for the last 2 years.
Right.
And, you know, just anything that happened to him, he'd go in the hospital for maybe like 2 or 3 days, sometimes a week or whatever, then come back home. My sister would nurse him back to health and he'd be good as new again. But this last time when he went down, we knew that, you know, and even the doctors had told us, like, you guys need to start preparing just because, you know, a lot of things are happening.
Did he know? Was he aware?
I think he was aware, but, you know, he was still, you know, my dad's a super strong man. And, right. You know, he was very faithful in God also, too. And that's why I think that he never became elderly. Even at his age, because
yeah,
of his faith, because of his faith in God.
I would guess he was 93, man.
Yeah, because of his faith in God. Yeah. I think that's what made him never become elderly. You know, until that last couple of weeks, and that's when
I hear you on that. Big said the same thing about becoming older.
Yeah.
You're older, but you're not elderly.
No, he wasn't elderly at all.
That's a very strong statement. Because elderly is like almost like a state of mind.
Yeah,
you know. And I wanted to say my uncle Jerry. He passed away from pancreatic cancer, and he had just 6 months.
My condolences, man.
What's that?
My condolences.
Oh, thank you. Well, this is back in 2014, and I had just moved in with him to kind of partly be there, and I needed a place, you know, and it just worked out for both of us, and he was 78. But it was weird because he had had a heart attack, and he didn't know he was having a heart attack. He went for a quadruple bypass surgery, you know, best doctors, he had great health insurance, all that. And then they couldn't find the cancer. That's how stealthy that shit is. Because then 6 months later, they diagnosed him with, and they're like, "Didn't you see it?" No, because that's what they're fucking silent killers, man.
It creeps up on you and it just takes over your whole body.
My point is there's nothing you can do. It's that the inevitable is happening.
Yeah.
All you can do is stand by and watch it happen.
Yeah,
and
the thing was just making him comfortable. You know what I'm saying? Like we my sister and I at that point were done with leaving him in the hospital and being around strangers. We wanted him to be around family.
Yes, of course. And my uncle said the same thing. He told my cousins, let me die in a hospital.
We took on the full responsibility of just taking care of him.
Hospice,
Yeah, hospice. Yeah. We brought him to the house and took care of him. And that's exactly what we had promised as children to both our mom and our dad.
Right.
And, you know, we were as bad and as you know, heartbreaking as it was, you know, it was still something that my sister and I, especially my sister was pretty much, you know, the one that to take care of him the most, you know, because he lived with her.
Right. I didn't even know you had a sister.
Yeah.
Younger sister. I mean, I've known you since I was 19 years old, bro.
Yeah, my younger sister,
now.
Jackie. Love you, sis.
Yeah. Well, shout out to Jackie, man.
Yeah.
My sisters, Ariana and Raina, they took care of my mom.
Yeah.
My sister's a pediatric nurse.
Yeah.
My sister Raina works for the court systems up in Nevada.
Yeah.
And it's just wild because, you know, for a while we were kind of estranged from each other.
Mm-hmm.
But then my mom's inevitable demise from liver failure,
which was
brought on by alcohol.
I remember your mom too. She was so nice,
man.
Yeah.
My mom, Diana. She would make us tacos, chicken tacos on my birthday and walk them around the station.
Yeah,
bro. Like there's so many good. And the good thing is the silver lining in losing a parent is how much, for me personally, how much it put things into perspective.
Yeah.
I stopped drinking.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't stop drinking right away. It took a while.
Yeah.
But I think I went a little heavier on the beer once my mom passed. I kept partying. Not maybe out of depression, out of coping.
Yeah, I mean, just to escape the reality for a second.
I mean?
Yeah.
It was my problem. Yeah. It was like I'm addicted to the partying and going out and being around all that. But then as I got older, I remember just one day I woke up on New Year's Day of 2021 after COVID or during COVID, but kind of on its way kind of into a more open state where people are getting back to work and whatnot. Right.
Right.
And dude, I woke up and I went and it was 6 o'clock in the morning. I went and bought myself a 6-pack of Stella on New Year's morning from 7-Eleven. And every sip I took, Choc, was like trying to drink like chlorine or something. You know what I mean? Like, it was like, my body was like, that's it. My body literally told me, that's it.
Yeah.
And from that point, I didn't go to AA. I didn't do any. I started smoking more weed. But I wanted to ask you, you stopped drinking as well.
Yeah. Right? I stopped cold turkey. I'm going to get to that right now.
Okay.
But I just want to talk about.
Go ahead.
So when my dad passed, 222.
Yes.
When I went to go take care of my dad, Byze had was in the hospital.
And this is so close to each other.
Yes, yeah. He was in the hospital from December. He went into the hospital in December, but I couldn't go see him because he had COVID.
COVID, right.
So I would just text him every day. Right. He'd send me videos, let me know how he was doing. We'd talk and everything. I was super worried about him.
Of course.
My biggest fear was him catching it. Just because I just knew like he was, he was always out, and I was just always nervous about that,
yeah,
you know.
Man.
And for me, when COVID like came around, I said, I'm out.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm staying home.
Same here.
You know what I'm saying? And, you know, I still wear a mask a lot today. But yeah, Byze got sick, and then he was in the hospital, and so I was interacting with him and trying to, you know, get ready to go see him whenever they would allow us to come, allow him to have visitors.
Mm-hmm.
And then in the midst of that happening, my dad got sick. And then that's when I went home to go take care of him. And then for those 2 weeks before my dad passed, Byze and I didn't get a chance to talk or anything. Mm. So my dad passed on a Tuesday,
right.
On 2/22.
Right.
And then Byze passed 2 days later.
Another two.
Yeah. But there's such a weird connection with everything with Byze and my dad, because it's like July 31st is Byze's birthday.
Mm-hmm.
My dad last year had a heart attack on Byze's birthday.
What the fuck?
July 31st.
I mean, and did your Byze and your dad, did they know each other?
My dad, Byze knew my family.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? They weren't close or anything, but he knew my family.
Right.
Yeah, they knew each other.
Which is, you know, pretty, these days when you know somebody's family like that.
Yeah, and I know his whole family, and I love his family, and shout out to the Ramirez family everybody, man. And I love you guys.
Yeah, man. There's a lot of loss happening lately, Choc.
Yeah. And
around everywhere. You know, a lot of people have lost, and it feels like a lot of times it's only happening to you.
Yeah, it really does, man.
Right?
It really does. It really does.
And it's consoling to know that it's not just you. And
yeah.
To know when your father passed, Choc, it affected me. I felt bad. I cried a little bit. I'm not going to lie. Like, I saw that post, and I was like, man, I never met your dad.
Yeah.
You met my mom.
Yeah.
And that was important to me.
Yeah.
I do want to ask you, like, in regards to your father and your sister, I'm sorry, and Byze and all this, and the void in general,
mm-hmm.
I wanted to touch on this. Is like, for me, it's been going on it's been 5 years. It's going to go on six
mm-hmm.
of my mom passing since 2017, right? That's 5 years, right?
Yes, 5 years.
All right, but for me, I still feel her with me.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like not only am I part of her, like I catch myself doing things that she did, like mannerisms and reactions to funny things on TV.
Yeah.
You know, I've talked about this prior on previous episodes of this podcast where I'm like, I found myself watching like a TV show and a joke will happen.
Mm-hmm.
And I repeat the joke the exact same way my mom would.
Yeah.
And I never noticed that till post her passing.
Yeah.
And that made me feel close to her. Do you ever feel these things? Do you feel like
your dad there's a lot of different things that, you know, I've noticed now, just my mannerisms, just my humbleness,
mm-hmm.
My faith. It's like I get that all from my dad. My inner strength, I get that all from my dad. Mm-hmm. But since he's passed, mm-hmm. What I see, and I never paid attention to this before, but what I see all the time, anytime it's 12/12,
mm.
you know, because that's his birthday,
right?
I say, what up, dad? Hey, dad, how you doing? And but I see it more than I ever have, ever. Like, I've never paid attention to it. But sometimes I'll look at the clock just at the right time, 12/12. And I know that's my dad.
And
I know that's him.
In 2019, what was happening? Anything? Or was it 2020, 2021? When did it start? Like, for me, the 2/22 thing became such a significant number for me in 2019. I won't go too deep into it. It has nothing to do with people passing or anything. It's more of a personal relationship, a friendship that I started with someone that hit me to the 2/22 situation, right? And since then, since meeting this person, I see 2/22 everywhere.
Yeah.
All on the way here, a bus passed. And, I, you know, I walk to work from my house. I live across the street. I walk and I see a bus. It's the 2/22 line.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, man, you know, and to me, it's just every time I see that number, it's very significant to me. And now it's even more significant because your father passed on that day.
Yeah.
And there's so many mathematical coincidences.
But it's just like, again, like for my dad to pass on a Tuesday and then Byze to pass, you know, 2 or 3 days later after that, you know, it's just like, it's all connected. It's all connected.
Yeah, man.
It's all connected. He had a heart attack on his birthday, and you know what I'm saying?
Your father.
Like, my dad had a heart attack on Byze's birthday, you know what I'm saying? And it's just so many other things I could go into, man, but you know, I miss both of them greatly. It's definitely affected me in a way that I never thought I would ever be affected. Having the two strongest men in my life leave at the same time
it's a double whammy.
It's a double whammy.
And a kick to the gut.
And then, you know, to even get crazier with everything, how everything's connected.
Go ahead.
Their funerals were back to back.
Wow. You mean the same day?
No.
Oh.
Meaning that my dad's funeral was on Friday and Byze's funeral was on a Saturday.
That's right. And, you know, I couldn't make it to Byze's funeral at that time. I will apologize for that. No. I was unfortunately having to work that day, and it was scheduled prior to me even knowing of Byze's condition, and I couldn't get out of it.
Yeah.
And I wanted to be there. I did. And I thought of him, and I still think of him all the time.
I was so amazed at everybody that had came out.
I heard it was
a
big turnout.
It was a very big turnout, man. And
for both funerals, you know, for your father as well?
My dad, yeah. It was mostly my family, which was cool.
And that was
cool.
All the way in Bakersfield?
Bakersfield, yeah.
And where was Byze's?
Byze's was in Long Beach.
That's right.
And, you know, there was a few friends that came down from L.A. for my dad's funeral also, too, which I definitely appreciated. But,
man,
you know, all my childhood friends were there at my dad's funeral. And then for Byze, you know, just to see so many people I hadn't seen in years, possibly a decade or whatever.
Yeah, right? It's like almost a reunion as well.
Yeah, you know, it was good to see a lot of people, but it was also, you know, Byze helped so many people.
Mm. A lot of artists, man.
Not just artists though, right. People. He touched so many people, and that's what made me a little bit happy at the funeral was just that. It wasn't just me as C-minus and Eric and Nick who experienced the good heart of Byze. Yeah. It was all these people who were at the funeral also, too.
Yeah, man.
And that I was grateful for.
It's a very consoling feeling knowing that there's people you don't know that he knew.
Yeah.
And vice versa.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
It's very beautiful. I was going to speak on just the void situation. I wanted to tell you this just from my own experience. I know your father just passed this year.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, you know, going on almost, well, it will be 6 years before I know it.
Mm-hmm.
But right now we're about five and some change.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that I felt this void and I still feel it, but I feel like the void becomes just somebody like, it just becomes like what they say, like a brick in your pocket. You just get used to it. It's not that you ever, it's not that it gets easier.
No, it
but
doesn't.
It does get easier because
It gets easier because you're able to
adapt
and deal with not having the emotional break. I never knew I could cry this year.
Yeah.
I didn't know I could still cry like that.
The most inopportune times.
Yeah.
And something random will just hit you or a scent in the air that will connect you to your childhood with your pops.
Yeah.
Something random.
Yeah.
It's not like a song always or a TV show. It'll just, you'll be in the supermarket and you'll see a product
something,
on the
shelf. Something will be like, boom.
Boom.
And then
same thing happened to me.
And then that
bro.
Emotion comes over you, you know what I'm saying? And I try my best not to tear up anymore. I'm trying my best not to do it right now as we're talking about this.
It's okay, man.
You know, it's been a...
Trust me, nobody's listening.
Stop that. Everyone's listening. It's been a... You know, definitely a year of me figuring a lot of things out after losing, again, like I said earlier, two of the strongest men I've ever had in my life.
Yeah.
One being my dad and another one being Byze. You know what I'm saying?
That was your brother.
Yeah. And both have been with me throughout my entire life. And, you know, Byze through a majority of my younger teen life
and into, not only that, but into
adulthood. Yeah.
And careers and at Power. I mean, he was a record rep, right?
Yes.
He was a record rep.
One of the best.
We could dive a little bit into that.
Of course
we
can.
Yeah. I know we're running out of time.
No, we're good.
But I do want to, well, let's see, how long are we at here? I just want to check. Oh, we're 42. Okay. Mm-hmm. But yeah, in regards to getting to Power and you know, let's go back now. And again, condolences for the losses and whatnot. And I'm so sorry, bro. And I know I can feel the weight of the heavy heart that you're carrying. I can feel it. And I know what that feels like, bro.
Yeah.
So I'm not just going to say like cliche, like, oh man, I'm so sorry. I am sorry. Cause I know what the fuck that is, man.
Thank you, man.
And dude. Yeah. I'm here for you, bro.
Yeah.
Not just, I know you came down for the podcast and we don't see each other talk that much. You know, we follow each other on Instagram and whatnot.
Right.
But, you know, nowadays, it's like reaching out to somebody almost seems like a nuisance. You know what I mean? Like, unless if you call someone outright, it's almost like a, like, what the fuck? You're not going to text me?
My thing is, when I reach out to people, it's like, I need to make sure my energy's good.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? I need to make sure, I don't want to be like talking to anybody about all my problems or all my issues or anything. Like, I've done that over the years, and it's just like, you know, it's draining.
Hey, man,
you
used to be there for me when I was at Power, and when we were at Power together, and I would have those rough nights sometimes, remember? And I would come in to talk to you as you did overnight.
Yeah, uh-huh.
And I remember it was early on. This is like, you know, 1998.
Yeah.
And I was a young man and just very intimidated by the position I held, and disappointing the powers that were above me, not just big, but, you know, at the time, Rick Cummings.
Cummings,
you know, you want
Michelle Mercer.
Everybody had their money riding on me.
Yeah.
And at times I just couldn't handle it. And you were there to listen to me.
Yeah.
And I remember even vividly, I remember coming into you one night, like probably crying. I was so upset. And I would stay there late. You know, it was only me producing. And this is early years.
Yeah.
And very naive Sketch-O-Matic. I wasn't even Sketch-O-Matic then. Mm-hmm. But I remember coming to you and going, like, Choc, and you were like, you just listened. And I remember after you were like, dude, Sketch, you're going to be all right, man. Just, you know, just hang in there. And you gave me the words, a voice of reason and a kind of a shoulder to cry on. But then I went back to the studio and I had the station on in the other office, like outside of the studio that I was in.
Uh-huh.
And I could hear you go on the air. And I remember you gave me a shout out. And you're like, man, shout out to my man, Sketch. I want to tell you, man, keep your head up. And I think you went into Tupac, keep your head up.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, man, like, that meant so much to me. And I remember in that moment, it occurred to me, like, here I am, the skinny kid from Culver City, working at Power now at 19 years old.
Uh-huh.
And I had Mr. Choc shouting me out and listening to my problems. So if I can return that favor and reciprocate that to you, regardless if it's on this podcast or if it's just a phone call, you can reach out to me anytime. And I'll be
I appreciate
there for you,
that man. So much, man. And you know, you've always been there for me, Sketch, and just thank you for everything. And even inviting me to this podcast, you know what I'm saying?
I've been wanting to have you on. You're a very living legend. You're very much a living legend in the hip hop DJing, not just hip hop, but in all of the music realm.
Thank you.
Because I know you can be open format. I've seen you do.
Yeah. Yeah.
I've seen you do the parties where you're going from like, I've seen you play like Happy Days into like Jay-Z and shit. You know what I mean? Like crazy. I'd get a bottle thrown at my head if I tried something like that. It'd be a riot.
Creative transitions.
Yeah, it's very nice, man. You know, it reminds me of like the Vice days, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Shout out to DJ Vice,
yeah,
man. My brother.
You guys definitely started a movement in the, to me, it was like AM, U, Vice, open format, kind of, it was very cool back then, being able, and playing on vinyl.
Yeah,
this is the other thing. You started on vinyl before Serato.
Yeah,
now everybody's a DJ. Granted, it's okay.
Yeah.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
But we're talking about lugging around heavy records.
Yeah.
And,
over 20, I didn't, my thing is that I was on vinyl for 20 plus years before Serato came out. So when I made the transition from vinyl to Serato, it made sense because I had 20 years of experience on vinyl. Now, most of these people who are getting on Serato now have never even touched vinyl before.
Now it's just a hipster thing.
Yeah.
It's cool. It's vintage.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, and I wanted to go back a little bit before we start getting into the DJ thing.
Rewind.
We were talking about alcohol. And like, I stopped drinking when I turned 40. I'm 52 now.
Wow. Damn. 12. Another 12.
Yeah. Yeah.
What the fuck?
I didn't even think about that, but you're right.
Pops
is
here, man.
Yeah. What's up? I didn't even think about that. But I stopped when I was 40 just because, you know, every year when I turn, every decade, I give up something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so when I turned 30, I gave up red meat.
Mm.
And I haven't touched red meat since.
Wow. Do you still eat chicken?
Oh, okay, like a animal, like a hunter. Rawr, chicken. Yeah. I try my best to stay away from fried foods also, too. You know what I'm saying? Especially as we get older, we got to definitely watch what we're putting in our bodies.
Right.
But yeah, I gave up drinking just because I went back to the days of, like I said, every decade I gave up something. So when I turned 40, I said, I'm going to give up drinking. But I also started thinking about where I was at that point in my career, and in my DJ life. Like, I was 30, I think when I started thinking about like giving up alcohol, I think I was like 37, 38. I was actually getting ready. I was going through a divorce at the time. And I was drinking heavily at that time also, yeah, too.
We drank together.
Oh, yeah. Man, shout out to the Hennessy brothers. DJ Echo.
Shout out to the Christian brothers, because that's
Eric Deluxe. DJ Ron.
Oh, my God.
My brother's right there. We used to drink
DJ
all the
Ron,
time.
DJ Ron, man.
Yeah,
oh,
DJ
man,
Ron.
Where is he? I want to say hi to him. First.
What up, Ron? How you doing, man? Ron's still doing
legend.
His thing. Yeah, he's super, super legend.
Quiet giant.
Eric Deluxe, too, man.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
I saw him at Priscilla's the other day.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, him and Scratchy.
Oh, wow. We're Scratchy. What up, Scratchy? Yeah, shout out to Scratchy. DJ Echo also too, yeah, man. That was my man, you know what I'm saying,
man. The Holla Boys.
The Holla Boys, yeah, for sure. Shout out to the Holla Boys. But yeah, I wanted to let go.
Yeah, what made you give up? What was it?
Every decade I gave up something. So I was turning 40. I said, okay, what am I going to give up?
Did it ever become a problem though, Choc? Did it ever
become I'm going to tell you why. Because at the age of 38, again, I'm kind of going through a depression. I had just left Power 106. I was gone. I left Power 106 in 2006 after an 11-year run.
Damn, bro.
And
it was that long?
It was 11 years I was there. Yeah,
wow.
Yeah. And, you know, I went through a depression moment for a minute because at that time I was separated from my ex-wife, who was my current wife at the time.
Right.
And I was getting ready to go through a divorce. So, you know, I went back on the club circuit, started traveling a little bit more. But I was in these clubs, man. I was drinking and just DJing and just doing way too much.
I remember those.
And so there was,
and that was like scam days too, right?
Yeah. Shout out to Sujit.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I mean, but this is like when it was just like a few of you.
Yeah, well, I was one of the first original members of Scam. You know what I'm saying?
This.
Along with like DJ 5, Vice.
Yes.
Obi-Wan,
yes,
Echo.
Those were the originators.
Yeah.
And the original bunch, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And you were traveling a lot. I mean, this is like at the beginning. Now, Serato had just kind of come out.
Serato came out in 2005. I bought it in 2005.
Right. It came out 2004. I remember J-Love.
Yeah.
J-Love,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Baker Boys producer back then.
Yeah, yeah.
In Miami.
He's at Dash now.
Yes.
Yeah. What up, J-Love?
DJ Ski.
Mm-hmm.
And, dude, just real quick sidebar on Serato.
Uh-huh.
I've said this before. I'm going to reiterate, though. I vividly remember the day I was moving back from Miami to L.A.
Uh-huh.
because I was going to work at 100.3 The Beat, right?
Uh-huh.
And I couldn't wait to get back to L.A. I was so excited. Love Miami, just wasn't for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember J-Love was like, well, can you come by my place? Because I was living with J-Love for a minute before I found my own place, right?
Uh-huh.
So he was such a great friend, another great friend that was always there and quite sober, but very, very hip for being such a sober guy.
Uh-huh.
And I remember he was like, Sketch, just come by my place. I want to show you this. This thing, you're going to have to see this. It's going to change everything. And I'm like, what is it? He's like, just come over.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, oh my God, it's mysterious. Drive over. Not too far from where I was staying in Miami. I drive to his place. He's like, all right. You remember how we said we wish you could DJ on our computers and stuff, right? And I have to care. He's like, well, this is it. This guy's made it. Check it out. And it's called Serato.
Uh-huh.
And I remember the box, and he had it set up on like a Dell computer.
Uh-huh.
And dude, the first time I saw it and he had it connected and I was like, what the? It was like seeing the iPhone for the first time.
Yeah,
it was like futuristic and just crazy.
Yeah.
And then I moved back to LA and I bought Serato probably about 2 years later.
Yeah.
But yeah, so you got it. That was just my little story. I just wanted to tell you how mystical it was.
Well, to go back real quick. So back to the alcohol thing, and we're gonna get into the Serato thing.
Go ahead.
So the alcohol. I stopped at 40 years old because again during that dark period of time, I realized that. Where am I at in my DJ career at this point?
Right.
Like every time I do a gig, I gotta have 6-7 shots of Patron, or I gotta drink an Incredible Hulk, or I gotta drink.
What's an Incredible Hulk?
Incredible Hulk is Hennessy and Hypnotic mixed together.
Shit.
Yeah. So, you know, Hennessy's brown and Hypnotic was blue, so you put them both together and they turn green.
I remember you like Hennessy and 7-Up.
Hennessy 7-Up, Hennessy Sprite, Hennessy Straight, Patron is...
I remember ordering you a Hennessy 7-Up. Real quick, did you ever get hangovers, Choc?
Massive hangovers.
And you'd have
especially
to
as I got older, my late 30s. Like I got, and that was another thing, too. I was like, man, like this
Did you ever get, like, belligerent? when you get black, did you ever get blackout drunk or a little violent?
It's happened a couple of times, but never violent.
You're just not like that.
No.
I've never seen you upset.
Oh, I get upset. Trust me.
Yeah, me too.
But I've never been like violent upset over alcohol or anything like that. Yeah. I think
God bless it. I've
almost gotten in a couple of fights being drunk. But,
really?
You know, but nah, I'm not like a violent dude.
No, I know,
you know what I'm saying?
You're a Pisces,
I can defend myself.
I know you can.
Best believe that.
Yeah, and you still got all your hair, which is another fucking thing. I mean,
it's a little salt in there now. It's
not, it looks good, though.
Salt and pepper. Push it.
It looks great. Push it real good. I mean, you don't have a receding hairline.
Oh, thanks,
you know what
man.
I mean? My friend DJ.
It is getting a little thinner. I will say that,
it's
though. My hair is getting a little thinner.
That's fine. Yeah. I mean, it's still, it's all the way down to your, the top of your ass.
Yeah,
much, right?
Yeah.
I mean, these are the original dreadlocks you've been growing since how long?
24, 25 years.
Man,
you know what I'm saying?
I can't
like
imagine.
That.
Do you think you're ever going to cut them? And then we'll get back
to
this is
my second time of having dreadlocks.
Interesting.
I cut them, I grew them for like 2 years and I cut them all off and went back to the fade thing. And, you know, I've always teased, I've had every hairdo a black man could have. Cornrows, afros, Jerry curls.
I can see you with cornrows.
Finger waves.
Yeah.
I've done all of it. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, when I cut my dreads off, went back to the fade for a little bit. And then I said, I'm going to grow dreads again. I think this is going to be it.
Yeah.
You know, I just want to wash my hair, twist my hair, and just keep it going.
Man,
you know
you're
what I'm
like
saying?
The DJ Obi-Wan Kenobi. Not DJ Obi-Wan.
What up, Obi-Wan?
When I think of you as a DJ, I think of like Obi-Wan Kenobi because of just like the force you're able to wield on those turntables,
oh,
man.
Thank you
wow,
so much,
dude. It's almost like superhuman. It's like seeing a superhero do the thing. Like DJ Fuse.
Uh-huh. Shout out to Fuse, man.
He's with the cruise show.
I got a story about Fuse, too. We'll get into that too. But going back to the alcohol again.
I want to tell you about my hair.
Uh-huh, go ahead.
I have my friend DJ Head who
what up, Head?
Pointed it out real quick to me one day because we took off our baseball caps.
Uh-huh.
And he was like, I was like, I got a receding hairline, bro. You should see. And he was like, damn, Sketch, you don't have a receding. You got a fucking drop top.
Cold as ice, Head.
Yeah, but it's very accurate. So now I always refer to my receding hairline as a drop,
top.
I mean, take a look at it real quick here. Check it out. I mean, look at that. That is, look at that. I mean,
I remember you when you had hair.
Oh,
you know what I'm saying? Yeah.
I had a full head of locks, and I was a very pretty man at one point.
Yeah.
A lot of girls like me.
Yeah.
Guys like me.
Yeah, but I mean, come on, man. Like you rock the bald head good, man.
I mean,
you know what I'm saying?
My mom blessed me with a nice round planet head. So thank God.
But, got the globe going on.
I kind of have like a dodo bird going on, though.
Not at all, man. Stop
but go
that.
On. So back to the alcohol.
So the alcohol, again, one of the reasons why I stopped, besides not only for it being a decade and me giving up something every decade, but it was also because I took myself back to the time when I first got into DJing.
Ah.
And what did I need? Was I smoking weed then? No. Was I drinking alcohol then? No. I didn't need anything to DJ.
Right.
And I felt like I was at a point that anytime I was at a club, like, I got to have two shots before I even started getting deep.
Just to get warmed
up.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I'm like, nah, man, that's not it.
Yeah.
That's not it. And so I decided when I turned 40, that's it. I'm going to have my last drink on my birthday, which I did. And that was it.
That was
a wrap. I never.
And did you need AA or
no?
Did you have any urges or
no?
Do you feel like you might relapse?
The hardest part was because I was a resident. I had like two residencies at the time in a club. So it was that first month was the hardest.
It's
because,
hard because you're
people
getting,
was people were still bringing me drinks and the bartender was still like, hey, here's your regular shots. I'm like, nah, I'm good.
Your usual.
Yeah. Here's the usual. Here's your six shots before you DJ. You crazy ass.
I remember Vice would say he was like, what did he say about that? He was like, DJing is the only job that pretty much requires you to drink.
But see, that
promoters bring you stuff, and it's almost not saying you have to drink.
And being in scam,
yes.
I'm gonna tell you something, God. Man. Like the promoters. Like anytime a new DJ would come to their city or whatever, promoters be like, yo, so you scam artists like the DJ. Let's see how you get down. And there was a couple of times, where I should not have partaken in any of that.
Twice, maybe.
Oh, I've done that. Yeah. I did. It was one time, it was a gig that was up north somewhere. And I remember the altitude was high.
Like Colorado?
No, it wasn't Colorado. I can't remember. It's going to come back to me in a minute. But I remember like they were just saying, like, when you drink, be careful. But the promoter was on me. He was like, yo.
Another one.
Yeah, another one. Let's see how much you can hang.
I know how they get down,
Man, like, 2-hour gig, I'm rocking. Everything's like, I'm just, like, everything's starting to get dizzy. I'm getting dizzy and stuff. So, dude, I make it through the set, right? 2-hour set, boom, I'm good. I walk off from the turntables, immediately go to the bathroom, throw up like I've never thrown up before. And then that's when I blacked out.
Whoa.
I blacked out after that. I had no idea. And I'm on Serato at this time. I had no idea. I remember waking up in my room. I had no idea how I got back to my room. I had no idea on how my equipment, like my computer, my records, and everything was all in my room with me. So the promoter was not only... was he a good dude to make sure I got back to the room, but he made sure all my stuff was with me also too.
With you.
And so I woke up and just like in a panic, like, oh my God, what happened?
Yeah, isn't that crazy? That's the other part of getting drunk and waking up when you're like, holy shit. It's like, it's like you time traveled.
Yeah, exactly. And I couldn't remember anything, man. And like, you know, as time has gone on, bits and pieces have kind of come back to me.
Yeah,
a little bit, you know what I'm saying? But like I wanted to avoid those type of situations. And that's what also prompted me to want to stop drinking also.
Eraser. It's not a good thing. And people are like, well, you know, you forget. It's like, yeah, I forgot where I put my keys, bro.
Exactly.
It's not like I forgot, like I told my best friend to go fuck himself. You know what I mean? Like,
but see, there has to be some discipline with that. Some discipline with weed also, too. I don't smoke before I do gigs. I don't smoke before I teach. I don't smoke before... I'm usually like, especially now because since the pandemic, I don't really smoke out in public anymore.
Right.
Just because I feel like now with all these different viruses and all this crazy stuff that's going on, like I gotta have all my senses
speaking
about me.
It, I'm vaping.
Yeah, it's all good.
I'm vaping my
thing.
Jewel.
Yeah, do your thing. But you know, like I feel like I need to have all my senses.
Absolutely.
When I'm outside,
be crystal clear
right. And just know so I can make good judgment calls.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? And not be, you know, sometimes I think with weed, like, you know, and I don't mind this, but sometimes I get like, do I want to do this or do I not want to do this?
Right.
You know,
you start analyzing too much. That's the thing
much.
About weed that I do enjoy.
Which is why I only do it at home now.
Yeah. See, I smoke all day. Like I'm like Snoop in that sense of like I won't smoke if I'm gonna do, obviously if I'm on a plane or something, which I don't go on very often. I don't travel much.
Uh-huh.
But anytime I do, it's like I know the time and place. I don't just smoke because it's legal in California and LA. I don't walk around with a joint. I don't even like joints. I smoke bong loads and vape. That's it.
Yeah.
But for me, I have to like it's my process. Especially with Juul.
Uh-huh.
I can't smoke weed in the station, unfortunately.
Right.
But like, you know, I'll be editing. And with the editing, just like with DJing and drinking, it's a part of the like I'll edit something, I'll play it 800 times, but I'll play it back and then I take a vape hit.
Yeah.
And then I listen to it, I take a vape. It's like ebb and flow of it.
But see, even for me, like let's say if I record a mix, right? I have to record the mix sober.
Right.
And then I'll go back and I'll listen to it sober also, too, to make sure everything is good. Then after I make sure everything is good, then I'll listen back to it.
A little high.
And I'll be like, I kind of did my thing
on
this mix.
Isn't that crazy, too, when you listen back to it and you're like, damn, that does sound pretty good. You know, like I'll hear some of my old imaging, even intros I've done back in the day for other DJs from way, like 10 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And I'm like, I made that? Of course, I was drinking and doing crazy amounts of fucking party favors.
Yeah.
Like, everything's a blur. I'm surprised I'm still alive, my friend. But like, dude.
I'm not going to get into a bunch of stories, but I have a lot of stories about you, Sketch.
Oh my God, bro. I mean, it's insanity. The amount of just crazy behavior and getting wasted.
I remember, you know,
please,
if you don't mind me.
Indulge me.
Okay, so there was one time.
Here we go.
This is when the ecstasy first came out.
Oh my God.
And it was like a popular thing. And just for the record, I've never done any drug.
I remember I gave you some and you lost it.
No. Yeah, I lost it.
I lost it in Miami.
Exactly.
Winter Music Conference.
Yeah. But I'll tell you that story too. So I remember when XD first came out and like it was all the rage and everybody was doing it. And I've never done any drug outside of weed. I've never done mushrooms.
That's not even
I've never done acid. Yeah. I've never done DMT.
You haven't done chemical synthetic drugs.
None of that. No coke, none of that crack.
I've never done crack or heroin.
I remember you invited me to your house and like we're having this like get together with a bunch of people, man, come over. And I just remember walking into your house, Sketch.
Yeah.
And everybody was on it. Everybody was just doing
rolling.
Yeah. So everybody was just doing something crazy. And I just remember I walked in there sober. I was probably high at the time when I walked in off weed or whatever.
But the sober is one of us all. That's
But I walked in, I just saw everybody kind of acting like, like different. Crazy.
And the thing was
is that everybody that was in there, I knew everybody.
Yeah. And so from the station.
Yeah. So to see them all acting the way that they were on Ecstasy, I was like, oh no, I'm never doing this.
Yeah. It's definitely a drug that, especially back then, because Molly nowadays is more pure in the sense it doesn't have all the side crazy shit in it. Mm-hmm. But now you got to worry about fentanyl and all that shit.
Yeah, man. I don't fuck with none of that shit.
I remember getting a lot of E.
But the ecstasy you gave me, and I took to Miami. This is when I was married.
Yeah.
And my ex-wife, she had it in her pocket.
Two of them.
She gave me two of them. Yeah. Gave me two. It was going to be one for me, one for her. And she put it in her pocket in her shorts, and then we went and got in the ocean in the water and swam, and they dissolved in her pocket.
And because
we were going to try it,
and
then she went in her pocket. She goes, "They dissolved." I said, "You know what? That's a sign."
Yeah, I remember you said
I go, "That's a sign that we shouldn't be doing this shit."
You know, it's probably better. You would have had a good time though.
Yeah, we probably would have
like had some sensual love making that night. You know what I mean?
Well, that happens without it.
The beauty of E and Molly. It does bring out it lowers the inhibitions in a different way of the serotonin being released.
Oh, look at
your
brain. You know.
And that's what makes you feel high. So really, it's not the ecstasy or the Molly getting you high. It's the fact of the chemical releasing the serotonin in your brain that's making you high. And then once that runs out, then you feel like shit. Then you're depressed.
Well, see, that's the thing. That's why I'm glad I never did it.
I'm sorry for trying to be a bad influence.
No, man. We were all young and being experimental at that time. So, yeah, it happens.
But it was exciting.
It's a part of growing up. Yeah. But another thing also, too, that prompts me to, like, not do certain things, certain drugs or whatever, and to give up, like, certain things at different times. My dad never smoked a drink.
Really? He was completely sober his whole life.
The entire life. I think he tried it at a young age and just didn't like it.
I just picture your pops having a cup of...
Now, my mom was a different story.
My mom
used to drink beer, and she smoked cigarettes.
Oh,
you know what I'm saying? No hard drugs or nothing like that, but alcohol was definitely...
Yeah, but those two drugs combined is rough enough.
Yeah.
You know, and they go hand in hand.
Yeah.
Literally, like, they're made for each other. Like the yin and the yang of legal drugs.
Yeah.
Cigarettes, for me, after vaping Juul, and I got it from Chappelle. I'm not personally. I saw him on his Netflix special.
Yeah, yeah.
And he had I was like, what is that fucking thing he keeps hitting?
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, so I kicked her in the pussy.
Yeah.
And then he like took a vape hit. And I'm like, what is that fucking thing?
And I'm afraid there's not enough stovetop stuffing for everybody. So I kicked her in the pussy. Bam! Ladies and gentlemen, I told you what I was going to say, and you still didn't see it coming.
And I went to a vape shop, and I'm all, what is that thing Chappelle is vaping? I pulled up my phone. I'm all, watch. And he's all, oh, that's a Juul.
Uh-huh.
And I'm like, I want one of those. And I hit it, and I remember I took about a week. I tried. I would get me dizzy and lightheaded fast.
Yeah.
But I tried to go back to cigarettes.
Mm-hmm. Couldn't do it.
It just tastes so disgusting to me. I was like, oh, I can't believe I smoked cigarettes for like a decade and a half almost.
Yeah, I never smoked cigarettes either.
Really?
I tried. I stole one of my mom's cigarettes when I was like 12, 13 years old.
What kind?
Oh, no.
Benson Hedges.
Benson the Hedges.
Really?
Yeah, that's exactly what she smoked. That's exactly what she smoked, yeah.
I love that.
And so I stole one and then went back to the backyard, tried to smoke it, and I was like, oh my God, it's like the worst thing I've ever like tasted in my life, and I swore I'd never do it, and I never did. Never tried it after that.
Yeah.
You know, even like if someone rolls like a gyro for me, you know what I'm saying? Like if it's like a weed and tobacco.
A fucking ale, mate.
I can't smoke those either.
Those are rough, man. Those will blast you into orbit real fast, dude.
I'm good on all that tobacco stuff,
it's
man.
It's too much, dude. The combination of weed and tobacco is very intense, for sure. It's like putting like espresso in espresso.
Mm-hmm.
It's too much. Mm-hmm. But yeah, okay, so... We're kind of running out of time here, Mr. Choc. So we're already in an hour, and I got to start my actual iHeart shift.
Oh, man.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. But, I mean, there's so much more to get to.
I mean, I will say this, man.
Go ahead.
I've been DJing for a long time, and I've been blessed now to
find another
hustle as far as teaching. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've been teaching for 17 years now.
Let's talk about the school real quick, the institute real quick.
Yeah, the institute.
Junkies.
I started off at Scratch Academy in 2005.
Yeah.
Teaching, but I had taught a little bit, like some private lessons before actually being approached by Scratch Academy. And so I had a little experience of teaching, but not a lot. But I really learned how to teach and understand how to present things to people who know nothing about DJing at all, right, and have them understand it.
Yeah, from the very, very basics.
Yeah, like I had to go back and re-engineer everything. No, yeah, I had to go back and like kind of like, okay, what is it that I'm doing? You know what I'm saying? What? How can I even explain
you're
this?
A professor.
Yeah.
You're Professor Choc.
I'm Professor Choc now,
I
yeah.
mean, and it's crazy how Mr. Choc goes hand in hand with you being the teacher, Mr. Choc. I mean, it's yeah. great. I mean, you could be Mr. Thurston. Can we say that, Mr.
Yeah,
Thurston?
Yeah, yeah, Mr. Thurston. Okay? Yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
Mr. Thurston's so such a sexy sounding name as well. You know what I mean? But I wanted to quickly ask you just in regards to the different groups that you Jurassic Five, right? You were part of Jurassic Five.
No,
but you DJed with them, didn't
no,
you?
No, we've just done a bunch of shows together.
Shows
but
together.
Those are all my that's
was
my
it
family.
Beat Junkies and yes, Jurassic Five.
Yeah, Beat Junkies and Jurassic Five.
I always.
So I'm a member of the Beat Junkie since 95.
I see.
We actually just celebrated our 30-year anniversary.
Yeah, congratulations,
of the Beat
man.
We actually just celebrated 5 years of our school actually being open also to, which is the Beat Junkie
yeah,
Institute of Sound.
Yeah, where is that?
Glendale, California.
Okay.
Right off of San Fernando.
I want to go there and just
please,
check it out.
Please,
today.
if you're interested
I'll in- I'll wear my mask and everything.
If you're interested in learning how to DJ or how to get better at DJing, if you already have a little bit of experience, come see us. We'll take care of you guys and make sure
I
you guys are
you
good.
Could probably teach
all,
me to be
all
better.
Ages too, you know what I'm saying? Well, yeah. Not all ages, but you know, like up to like eight years old and up.
Here's a good question.
Mm-hmm.
Youngest student you've had, oldest student you've had since you've opened?
Youngest student I've had, it's probably 7 or 8 years old.
Wow.
Yeah. And oldest, I'll say maybe like 65.
Dope.
Yeah.
And obviously the youngster never DJ, but the 65-year-old, did they have
yeah,
any
like,
experience?
Yeah, like pretty much like...
Or are they just starting like a baby
script? Well, the older DJs who come in sometimes, these are the DJs that used to like DJ in college or whatever, and like, and then they end up getting a family, right. like starting raising a family.
Become
and,
accountants.
Yeah, come become accountants yeah. and find another profession.
Right.
And then they eventually come back. I used to do this in my college days.
Yeah,
I still got it, you know what I'm saying?
I'm going to show you guys what's up.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Have you ever gotten any of those guys, any students?
Oh, yeah. There's always.
Show you up?
Yeah, but then they come in and they learn like, oh, I got a lot to learn.
Yeah.
Yes, you do. That's
especially,
why you're here.
Especially because
you know
Mr. Choc is in charge.
Yeah.
Did you volunteer or how did you become the professor, the one to teach? Obviously, it's not you the only one teaching. There's
no.
DJ Maddox there too, right?
Yeah, the whole Beat Junkie crew.
So
myself and Babu are pretty much are the main instructors
gotcha.
at the Beat Junkie Institute of Sound.
Right.
We're there pretty much every day.
But my question is... Who voted you? Or do you guys vote? Do you guys go? Who's going to teach? Who do you?
No.
Who
well,
you think is
again, like again, my teaching started in 2005 at Scratch Academy. So I had 11 years experience.
I see. So you already had a little bit.
I had 11 years experience when we decided to make our own school, and when we decided that, I was still at Scratch Academy at the time. So we started talking about our school at the end of 2015, and we said, "Yeah, why don't we make a school?" And so I was like, "Yeah, you know, like." And I'm just thinking like, oh yeah, we're just throwing ideas against the wall,
right.
and like if it comes to that, we'll eventually make a school.
And then you find a building and all that.
But then the guys were really gung ho about it, and it's like, well, on me, like, so what's up, man? You want to do this? You want to do this? And we know you got a job already at the Scratch Academy, but you know, once we get our school, you're gonna have to leave there and come over here. And I was like. I don't know, man. You know what I'm saying? Like, well,
you had to kind of weigh it out.
Just because, again, I had a job.
Yeah,
I had a title. I was
set.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So
and this is a whole new, unknown, uncharted territory.
Exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
Man,
but then, you know, the opportunity to work with my brothers that I've been rocking with.
Let's shout out the Beat Junkies.
Yeah,
quick,
of course.
Name by name, one by one.
Man, so many of us.
Yeah. Go ahead.
J-Rock, Mello D, D-Styles, Shortcut, Babu. Redmatic, Icy Ice, Havoc, Curse, and yours truly,
there
Mr. Choc.
Is.
There it is.
Is it 10?
It's 10 of us now. We started off with 13.
Wow.
It's like it's 10 of us now.
Right. Other people went their own ways.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, well, everyone's just like, you know, life takes over.
Of course.
Like families and, you know, other occupations
but
or
man,
whatever.
Beat Junkies has been around for how long?
30 years now.
30 years.
30 years now.
I mean,
started in 1992 by J-Rock.
That's 3 decades, by the way.
Yeah.
I just
yeah.
like saying that.
Yeah.
It makes me sound
decades.
Like I went to college, but I didn't.
But yeah, you know, like they, at the end of 2015, we started talking about it. And then 2016, it started becoming more of a reality. Like, okay, let's sit down. Like,
how do you get the building? Or the
we just went and just started like
just
scouting out. And you
wow.
know, and I had to be careful because again, I had a job at Scratch Academy.
And so you're
so,
kind of like side busting a little bit.
Yeah,
but I know
a little moonlighting, if you will.
Moonlighting. I love it.
You know what I'm saying? Like doing a little of that. And
It's always a kind of a guilty feeling, but at the same time.
It was a guilty feeling, but at the same time, like, I didn't know what it was going to turn into. So I was definitely, like, again, the opportunity to work with my brothers and some of my best friends on this planet. Like, yeah, let's try to do it.
That's your family, your chosen family.
Exactly. Yes, so when we finally found the building and we made the decision to go ahead and you know, make it happen, now the decision was on me. Like, how am I going to leave this job that I'm pretty much the boss of?
How did they take it?
It was taken, you know, at the same time, what was happening in my life is that I was getting ready to be a grandfather too.
I know. Congratulations on that too, man.
Thank you.
Even though you don't look like a grandfather.
I was getting ready to be a grandfather. I was getting ready to move from the place where I was staying at the time. And I was like, okay, you know what? It's time for change. I see these things happening. Like, everything was the writing was on the wall. It's time for me to leave this school. It's time to go build and have something for myself. Be an owner, be a boss.
Dope.
You know, and I was a boss at Scratch also too.
You've always been a boss.
But I wanted to be an owner.
You're officially a boss though, and an owner. God bless you, man. I want to ask you before we wrap up completely, and there's so much more I want to talk to you about, but let's go all the way back to the beginning that we never got a chance to really sum up.
Okay.
Who, besides the Bakers and you being part of the B-Boy crew back in Bakersfield and all that, what was it that got you to power? Was it the Bakers doing Friday Night Flavors and you being friends with them that ultimately got you
Baker
the job?
Boys co-signed for us.
Yes.
But it was myself and C-Minus. We were working at the station called KKXX in Bakersfield. We were working at another station called Power 1490 in Arizona. So we would have to do shifts on the weekend at KKXX in Bakersfield, and then we would record a mix for Power 1490. Boogie D, shout out to Boogie D.
Right.
Boogie D and Bruce St. James, who was the music director at Power, who was the music director at Power 106 at the time, used to work with Boogie D.
Yeah.
And so Boogie D slid Bruce St. James one of our tapes. And from there, Bruce St. James and Michelle Mercer asked for a meeting with us. They sat down with a dinner with us. They tried us out in the mix. And then that was in November of 94.
Wow.
And then we tried out and they liked us and they invited us back to come back and do, I think they were just getting ready to start the Cali Caliente mix weekends.
Damn.
And they invited us to come back to do that. Well, I wasn't a part of the conversation. I love my brother C-Minus, but I got to tell the story. So C-Minus had kind of answered for both of us, like, well, no, it's the holidays. We're not going to be able to make it down for that. You know, because we were both new fathers at the time
too.
So he wanted to spend time with his son. I wanted to spend time with my kid and with my son at the time, because my daughter was barely on the way.
Right.
But I was so upset with that, because it's like, yo, you answered for both of us.
Right.
So then when we called back to Power to Michelle Mercer, she was like,
no, we're good.
We're good.
We already turned down
the opportunity.
Wow.
And so I was like, no, we just did not just fuck up our dream job opportunity.
How does it come back? Oh my God.
So then I said, you know what? I'm going to become a pest. And so that's what I did. So then what I did, I took all of our air checks, and I combined one of the best air check tapes I could possibly make.
And this is before Pro Tools and all the computer.
Yes.
You're editing on what? What did you edit on? Reel to reel?
I think I was doing reel to reel. Yeah, wax pencil. Wax pencil. Splicing, brother. I was getting my splice on.
I got that where I started at. And wax pencil and tape.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, man.
And so I put together like this 5-minute presentation air check for us of me and C-Minus, and I sent it to Michelle Mercer again, hoping and praying to God that she would give us another opportunity.
And
when she got the tape, she loved it.
She
hit us
back.
But she didn't want to hire. The thing is, when we first tried out, we were just going to be hired as mixers, DJs.
You wanted to be on air.
No.
Oh.
I was just wanted to be hired as a DJ. I wasn't even thinking about that. But, you know, I had on-air personality experience.
Sure.
So I was like, you know what? Let me put something else together for her and send her this, and maybe she'll want to like mess with us. And so
she went the extra mile.
Yeah. So when she got the tape, she was like, I love the tape. We are looking for some more personalities, so you can come and do overnights. But we weren't mixing. Mm-hmm. So we were not power mixers.
We
were never hired as power mixers. Wow. We were hired as on-air personalities.
But then eventually you started DJing on.
Yeah, because they knew we could mix also too.
And then you took
over
Friday Night Flavors.
Yep.
And that's when I got there.
Yeah.
When I got there, Well, the Bakers were still, they were doing
Well, remember but, yeah. Friday Night Flavors used to be the Baker Boys and then Funkmaster Flex.
Right,
so
yes.
So it'd be, well, the Baker Boys would
another
be.
Another guy who doesn't age.
Yeah, for real. What up, Flex?
It's eerie. It's just eerie at this
so,
point.
So Baker Boys would do, 10 to 12, and I think Funkmaster Flex would do 12 to 2 or something like that, 12 to 1 yep. maybe. But it was a pre-recorded mix.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And the thing was that at the time, Flex's mix wasn't connecting with the LA community, and at this time, like LA underground hip hop was bubbling.
It was bubbling. Mystical,
it was the groups that were coming through, like the Visionaries.
Yeah. We're Mexican, Islander, Euro, African, Asian. Celebrate Creator before creation. Division, we're erasing.
Dilated peoples.
Dilated.
Words come to words, my peoples come first.
I got worldwide family all over the earth, and I worry about them all for whatever it's worth.
On Jurassic 5.
Yep. We're not falling. We take it back to the days and yes, y'all. We're holding on to what's golden.
On the stage, I rage and I'm rolling.
These were groups that were like not being.
Right.
The spotlight wasn't put on them right. because, again, like this mix was. That Flex was doing, it was a good mix, but it was all New York.
Yeah,
underground hip hop.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with
J-Roo
that.
Through the damage.
Exactly.
You got a freaky flow. Control the mic like Fidel Castro.
We wanted something more local to spotlight.
For our demographic.
For LA.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And so that's what we did. Myself and C-Minus, when they brought us on after they took Flex off, we started like, you know, Fat Beats was
you
like
tailored
the
tailored it to LA.
Exactly.
And it worked.
Exactly.
It did work.
And it worked.
And you were there for such a solid run. And I was sad when you left.
Eight years.
Eight years
of Friday Night Flavors, 11 years of just being an employee at Power 106, an on-air personality, and 6 years being in a primetime slot, meaning from 2000 to 2006, I was doing pretty much 4 hours a day on the air. So I'd be on from like 12 to 2 with Kool-Aid.
Yeah.
And then that turned into like 12 to 2 with Yessie.
Yes.
Yessie Ortiz. Shout out to both of those ladies. It was a pleasure working with both of them, those queens.
Yeah.
And then I would do that. Let's take it back a little bit. So, 99, I was still doing overnights and I was working. I would do 10 to 12, the Doobie mix with Sun Doobie, who used to be on at nights, 10 to 12. And then 12 to 6, I would do overnights just on air.
Mm-hmm.
And then Jimmy Steele, when he got there, he came in, and I remember he came in and watched my whole two-hour mix. He sat in the mix room and watched my whole two-hour mix and just was watching me the entire time.
Yep.
And then like after the mix, he was like, you know what? We're going to move you. We're going to put you somewhere else where you can really get the light you need.
Wow.
And shout out to Jimmy Steele, man, because he saw something that I didn't even see in myself at that time. He saw something in me, and he made me pretty much the star of Power at that time, as far as at least the star mixer.
Right, I'll say.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I would do the 12 to 2 with Kool-Aid, and then later on Yessie, and then I would be on with the Goodfellas and Tito from 5 to 7 every day. So I was doing 4 hours of mixing a day for six years on vinyl. The last year was on Serato.
Right.
So that last year from 2005 to 2006, it just came out.
But dude, you really put in the work, man. And not only that, but I wanted to say, like, when you left, I remember we didn't take your name off the door for like a year. I remember Mr. Choc stayed there. The nameplates. Remember they had just kind of redid the building.
They redid
the building every few years.
Yeah, but
this the last time right before you left, they redid the building, and then you left. And I remember E-Man was like I was like, oh man, Mr. Choc's name. He's like, yeah, just leave it. We're just gonna leave it. I remember everybody's like, don't touch that. It's like, that's sacrament. You can't fucking touch it. And eventually they took it down. I think once we switched, they switched sides.
They went
to the other side of the building, and then that whole thing got taken. But that name stayed there, bro.
But I'm grateful for
my
experience with everybody I worked with, and my experience at Power 106. It definitely helped shape and mold me into the DJ that I am today, being on that platform and performing. Reinventing myself on an everyday basis as far as DJing and mixing was definitely a challenge, but I'm definitely glad that I experienced that at my young age, because who I am now as a teacher and still as a DJ has definitely taken me to another level. And my confidence and you know, I'm still very humble,
but
I'm confident on who I am
and
what I can bring to any table that I'm pulled up to, you know,
and
what I'm saying?
Any turntable,
exactly.
Man,
pun intended.
Friend, you've done quite a bit in your still ongoing adventure of life.
Yeah.
And not only being at Power and DJing for as long as you have, but also being my friend for quite a long time,
man,
as well.
Man,
I
appreciate that also too, because I could just, you know, a couple of years ago, 2 or 3 years ago, I called Sketch just to like, hey man, I need an intro for a podcast that we're doing with the Beat Junkies, and can you do that? He was like, no problem.
Live from the Beat Junkie Institute of Sound, the Building Better DJs podcast with the Beat Junkies.
There you go.
Made us the intro. Boom. Here you
and
go.
And I don't do that for everybody anymore. I don't even do the intros anymore. I took the whole Intro Man LLC. I dissolved it because it just wasn't, I wasn't making enough money.
Yeah.
And I don't make intros. In 2010 is when I started it. And I'd been making intros for a few years prior to that, you know, for Vice, for you, for Echo and all that.
Yeah.
But I remember I didn't really make it a thing until 2010, mm-hmm. and I made it official.
Mm-hmm.
And then the Sketch-O-Matic, the Intro Man, became like a its own little business. But then after a while, like, you know, I pretty much made intros for almost every DJ that knew of me.
Right.
And by this point, they were just like, no, we're just using the same one you made for me like 10 years ago.
Oh, damn.
And I'm like, that's great. Right. But then I started working here, and then I started doing more, you know, production elsewhere. Uh-huh. But paying for an LLC every year is not cheap.
Oh, we know.
And getting out of it, I've never been married, but getting out of it is like going through a divorce.
I know
it's
that too.
Insane. But Mr. Choc, it's such a pleasure to have you on, and I hate to have to wrap this up, but I have to go and do my actual regular job.
Hey, man, I just want to say, man, it is a pleasure to know you, Sketch,
you
and
too.
To see you and to see your growth and see how you've evolved into the man you are that's
Thank
sitting
you.
In front of me today,
yes.
man. You've always been an amazing talent, an amazing friend.
Thank you.
And I'm so grateful to have you in my life.
Likewise.
And
I'm
man,
fortunate.
And I'm applauding you from the sidelines all the time, and every time I see something that's great that's happening for you, man, I'm just like, yeah, that's the man.
Same here, man. I
because
see that
you're,
for you too.
There's
the
no better voiceover dude in the business, you guys. I'm gonna tell you guys this right now, as far as like just production, pre-production, imaging, all that, this is the man right here. Sketch-O-Matic,
thank
man
you.
Love you, brother.
Mr. Choc,
yeah,
friends for life, homies for life,
brothers,
bro.
For life, man.
And
yeah.
family for life,
yeah,
bro.
For
I'm
sure.
always gonna be there for you no matter how much time goes between us.
Yeah.
I'm right near the water tower here, man.
Yep.
So
I'm gonna come hang out.
Just come through. Let's go grab some poquito mas or something.
Yeah, let's
know?
Make it happen.
But Mr. Choc, in closing and to sum up, any closing words of wisdom you want to share?
Just know that whoever you are today, you could always reinvent yourself. You could always start over. It's never too late. And just believe in yourself, man. Love yourself. Keep your faith in God. Keep your feet on the ground.
Mm.
And just be grateful for the people that you have in your life, because man, things happen really, really
Real
fast
quick.
Sometimes, and you just got to know how to, you got to be able to recover from these things when they happen. But you know, be grateful for the people in your life, be grateful for your family, and just be good, man. Just be a good person. That's
there
all there is to
man.
It. All right.
I want to hear that story about DJ Fuse too.
Yeah, definitely. I definitely will tell you.
Would you come back for another episode?
Of course I will.
Okay.
Of course I will.
Thank
yeah.
you, man. Mr. Choc, I love you, bro.
Love you too, Sketch.
All right,
word up, man.
Till next time.
Yes, sir. Peace.
Peace.
Oh, good for you. And how was it?
The Sketch-O-Matic Show.
Hey, too much information and shit, man.
Shut your mouth, SA.
Okay, bye. Woo.